seems like it's malfunctioning.
The difference is that the microphone's
not working.
If I talk loud enough, it doesn't matter.
Cool.
So I'll try to do that. Okay. What's this?
Galaxy.
All galaxy?
It's our galaxy.
It's our galaxy. Which has a name?
The Milky Way.
That's it. Artist's rendering. Okay, there is no... We don't have the technology to take that picture. But we do have a lot of information that about our galaxy. Notice the terms here. That's not our planet. Okay? That's our entire solar system. So that would be our sun right there. With us rolling around it. A little perspective for you. What do you notice about this galaxy of ours? Why did you do this?
It's
like a
hurricane. Kind of like a hurricane, doesn't it? Rotating, right? And it is, turns out. It is believed that the center of our galaxy is a black hole. And into that, everything is headed. So that's not a sun there. That's not a star in the center of the galaxy. What you're seeing here is a lot of stars all kind of overlapping one another as they get closer and closer to that center. Okay, does that make sense? I don't want there to be a misconception that there's some massive star in the center of the Milky Way. But just some perspective here. We're here to talk about Earth as a planet, like a physical sphere, as a rock. Okay. We've talked about the liquids, we've talked about the gases, here we're talking about the solids. Okay. Same principles being applied. Energy and matter moving, high to low energy, all these things are happening. Okay. In a different setting. Okay. I'm going to go back here just to make sure we cover that. Okay. Describe the formation of Earth. This is going to be in a very general sense. Okay, if you've done your reading already, you've read that little description they have in there. That's basically how I'm going to do it today. Probably I'll use a few old words. Okay, that's not a huge part of what we're trying to get here, but we want to understand that Earth had its origins, and Earth at its origin and Earth now are two very different places, and there's a lot of reasons for it. So the formation of Earth, think of it as like the formation of Earth as we know it. The critical, the distribution of elements, we're going to do more on mining later, but that's a small part of our conversation today. The theory of plate tectonics, that's a big part of our conversation today. So we want to be able to define it. I do kind of my own definition here. We want to be able to explain what's all about, how we know, or why we think this is happening. And then the rock cycle. This is something that's going to come back to us as many of these topics have. I've been saying that a lot, I feel like. The rock cycle describes how matter is moving through the solid Earth. You know, we talked about matter moving through the atmosphere. Let's talk about how it moves on the surface. Okay. So, that's our galaxy. This is a representation of our solar system. Not to scale, but just for reference. Here we are, Earth and the Sun, just at the right distance to be comfortable. As we move away from the Sun, we encounter these, what we're calling the gas giants. Gases, they're less dense, right? Well, it's not surprising that these would be on the outer reaches of our solar system. Okay, for example. And there's stuff going on out there past Pluto. I honestly don't know if we've decided that Pluto's a planet again or not. Anybody know? It wasn't, then it is, and now it's like, who cares? I don't know. I wrote a report on it once. I thought it was. That was a long time ago. But there's stuff going on outside of that, stuff that we think is there that we haven't really seen very much. Interesting things in our solar system. Still going on. We're here talking about Earth. So I'm going to do this. I'm going to let this play for just a couple minutes to give you a little bit of an overview, some examples of the types of things we want to be able to explain. Okay. from a documentary made about the formation of North America as a continent. And like I guess I'll just play the first couple minutes. It goes fast. They give you a few examples, like I said, but it's like Utah, one after the other. So don't worry right now about like frantically writing down notes. You can go back and watch this later. In fact, you can watch the whole 4.5 minutes of it. But for now, just look and listen.
You're so used to seeing your town, your city, or even your continent that it's easy to forget. Everything on the planet used to look completely different. But this tour will take you coast to coast, showing you some highlights of how North America took its shape today. Take a look at New York City. Today, it's a grid of streets lined with enormous buildings. But there are strange rocks all over the city, hinting at an earlier, far different landscape. About 450 million years ago, a chain of volcanic islands headed towards the coast, bulldozing mud from the seafloor, and pushing up mountains 10 times taller than any skyscraper in the city. As the mountains eroded away, mud from the sea compressed into Manhattan schist. This bedrock makes strong foundations for the towering skyscrapers that make up this amazing skyline today. Now let's go to the Rocky Mountains. As permanent a fixture as they seem now, these spectacular peaks haven't always been here. Before the Rockies came the ancestral Rocky Mountain Range that dominated the landscape here. Erosion ground these mountains down into sand and pebbles, which were buried and crushed into sandstone slabs. Millions of years later, violent forces pushed up the Rockies version 2.0, lifting and tilting these sandstone slabs sideways. This created the Flatirons that can be seen in the foothills of today's Rockies. Nearby in Zion National Park, sandstone forms the sheer walls of the cliffs. That's because this place used to be all sand. The ancestral Rockies disrupted the atmosphere, preventing moisture from reaching this land, transforming it into a vast desert with dunes piled upon dunes. But some of the most surprising clues of the continent's past come from fossils. Here in Kansas, you can find bones of an 80-million-year-old fish that was 14 feet from end to end. So what was a fish doing here in the dry plains of Kansas? 130 million years ago, after the ancestral Rockies had eroded away, oceans flooded the land, creating a vast, warm sea that split North America in two. Not far away, at the Kaiparowitz Plateau in Utah, the bones of scores of dinosaurs from this hothouse world had been discovered along what was once the coast of the Inland Sea.
Okay, so a lot happened over the course of hundreds of millions of years. that's obviously important to remember, but there is a lot of evidence, right? I've been using that word a lot, and we want to be able to explain that. We want to be able to look at a place and look at some of this evidence and use our knowledge of these plate movements to piece together a reasonable explanation of like what happened here and how this place get this way. Okay. So if you took all of that, you know, this term dynamic I've used before to describe Earth and Earth systems, this is another example of it. Okay. Over the course of, so everything they just described, going back 130 million years ago, was all during, if you look at the scale here, during the Cretaceous period. The Cretaceous period ended about 65 million years ago, and this is when the dinosaurs went extinct. Each of these periods is denoted by some kind of notable change, some kind of observable change that appears to have happened, usually or often some kind of mass extinction, meaning if we look at the fossil record, we find a lot of bones showing up at the same time, a lot of places, mass extinction. And all of those mass extinctions are thought to have been correlated with or somehow connected to some kind of large-scale environmental change. Okay. Maybe that was just some natural climate fluctuations related to the tilt of the Earth, or maybe it was related to land masses, changing their orientation to one another. For example, they talked about Utah, Zion National. apart, and how it was all sand. It was a massive rain shadow desert from the original Rocky Mountains. Our Rocky Mountains right now, not the originals. For example, okay? Earth, so that was all relatively recent. If you take Earth as a whole, going back 4.5 billion years, that was all relatively recent. Yet, on a scale of time, that is hard to comprehend for us. So 4.5 billion years ago, 4.5 billion years ago, Earth formed as the rock that is Earth, this sphere, this mass that is orbiting the sun, took shape. And it took shape from chaos. In the solar system itself was formed. Okay? Matter moving through space, which is there, I should point out, as a result of stars collapsing. Okay, when a star collapses, it essentially explodes and spews all of its matter through space. And all of that matter is moving through space in all these different directions, and it starts to accumulate in some pockets. And over time, it starts to you get a gravitational pull around some kind of, this energetic system, and we end up with these rocks colliding and planets forming, and we have the origin of Earth. Shortly thereafter, and by shortly I mean a few hundred million years, there's this age of bombardment. What that's referring to is this period of time when early Earth was still like a molten rock, and it was being bombarded by other molten rocks in the solar system that were whipping around the new sun, and everything's kind of settling down. This goes on for millions upon millions of years. And eventually this really energetic system starts to kind of cool down a little bit. Things are taking shape, things are settling down in orbits around the sun. All of that energy has been transferred and moved through the, moved on through the universe and places. And our solar system is taking shape, our planet's taking shape. Once things calmed down to the point that life could evolve, it did. And that was a long time ago. This is way earlier than it was originally thought. When people started talking about the origins of cellular life and stuff, it wasn't expected that it went back that far, but there's evidence to suggest that it does. And it would have been, they think, under the surface, because the surface of the Earth was still a really harsh place. There wasn't much of an atmosphere to speak of. There was no liquid water. It was really hot. It was still a lot of molten rock. It was still shaping itself in a lot of ways, still cooling. It would have been a hard place for a cell, as we know cells anyway, to survive. But under the surface, in these little pockets of water and air, they were. We continue and we see oxygen building up in the atmosphere. This is the result of photosynthesis. And this is where we start to see cellular life, life in general, affecting the global system. Oxygen builds up in the atmosphere because photosynthesis is happening. That oxygen in the atmosphere starts to accumulate to the point that we get an ozone layer. If you're exposed to oxygen, O2, which is UV light, you get O3, ozone. And that forms an ozone layer now, which started back then when we started to build oxygen up in the atmosphere. And that ozone layer now regulates a lot of our climate down here by reflecting and absorbing UV light. And on we go, right? We work our way towards this moderate climate, water-covered planet where life is covering it from this origin of a fiery mess. Okay. So here we are on the crust, of the Earth. This is the cooled the rocks that have reached the surface and cooled off. They've become solid. Underneath the crust, we have magma, which is melted rock. And as we move through the core is actually so dense and under so much pressure that it is actually solid. It is also incredibly energetic, incredibly hot, and all of that heat, all of that energy is radiating outward. It's convection. Okay? And that convection, the force of all that energy, is pushing off the crust. Okay? is broken. Okay, the force pushing outwards on it has forced it to crack, and now we have what we call plates. There are seven major plates, and they're all colliding with one another and moving in different directions along these plate boundaries. So that is, in my own words, the theory of plate tectonics, basically. Okay? From the core is radiating outward, there's convection currents causing the crust on the surface to be in motion. Okay. A couple of things to take away from this. We're going to talk a lot more about plate boundaries on the next slide. The two big things, I like the diagram in the top corner there, spreading zones and subduction zones. Spreading zones happen where plates are coming apart from one another, they're diverging. This opens up space for magma to come and fill. That's where we get a new crust, okay? New, brand new Earth's crust forming here as magma comes up and cools and spills over and hardens into a crust, okay? At the same time that's happening, we have what's called subduction zones, shown here on the edges. This is where two plates are coming together. One's getting pushed under the other one, and we have crust being cycled back down to the main. Okay. More on that in a second. It's kind of an important idea. Like we're in a new crust. It's kind of an interesting condition. Where does that happen? Well, it happens where magma can reach the surface. What about this question here? We're talking about density a bit. I alluded to it with the planets a little bit. What is the most common metal in the Earth's crust? This would be easier if I gave you a periodic table. So sorry. I feel like we can figure this out. What is the core made of? Do you recall that? Iron. Iron is a heavy metal. One of the heavier ones we have naturally occurring. What's a lighter metal? Yes, that one. Aluminum. Aluminum is, if you look at the periodic table, is the lightest of the metals. After that, we get into metalloids and weird stuff. It is also the least dense. Not surprising, therefore, that it would be the most common in the Earth's crust. Not to say we don't find lead and iron and other really dense, heavy things in the crust. We do, but the most common one in the Earth's crust is the least dense. An example, again, of that kind of thinking, right? Like, well, if this is true, then this must be true. If I know that the least dense things are going to rise to the top, and I'm talking about a metal, what's the least dense metal we can hope to be? Questions here? Plate boundaries. There are three main types. There they are. Talked a little bit about divergent boundaries already. The classic example of this is shown at the top in the middle there. The Mid-Atlantic Ridge goes right up the center of the Atlantic Ocean Basin. It's the longest continuous mountain range on the planet. And it is a mountain range. It's just underwater. And those mountains result from magma coming up and spilling over the edge. Forming these landforms. Iceland, if you look at the top of that tiny little map, is this little kind of outcropping of the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. And you can see it there. Those are the two plates. North American plate is that way, the Eurasian plate moving that way. Centimeters a year. It is measurable, it is noticeable, and it is all the time. Okay, divergent boundary. Iceland is ripe with seismic activity because of its location, and we'll talk more about that. It becomes significant when we talk about energy resources, for example, renewable energies, interesting stuff there. So divergent boundaries. Convergent boundaries are where plates are coming together. Okay. Now, I showed this image. I got this one here. There's other ones in your book. I like this one for a few reasons. One is that it fits really nicely. When subduction happens, we want to be able to pick out some evidence of that, and, or vice versa, like given a description of a place, could you figure out your subduction? Subduction. This happens when plates are coming together, but more specifically, when over here, continental crust and oceanic crust are coming together. So continental versus oceanic crust. When I say continental crust, and I'm going to go back to the silk here, I'm talking about dry land. Okay? If you look at the North American plate, it includes continental crust and oceanic crust. Okay? It's all one plate. But we have these two different kinds of crust. And they differ in their composition and their density. Continental crust is a lot of granite, which I'll show you an example of in a minute. Oceanic crust, a lot of basalt, which is similar but different. So when two things meet, where does the more dense thing go?
Down.
Okay. And that's where the oceanic crust goes. It's pushed under, the continental crust stays on top. And all of these things, you see all of the stuff here. You see mountain ranges, okay? This is the result of that continental crust being crunched up against that oceanic crust and getting pushed upwards, just like was described in the video I showed a few minutes ago. We also get, in this specific setting here, ocean crust and continental crust, we tend to get these deep ocean trenches. If we look in the Pacific, the South and Western Pacific, we see a lot of deep ocean trenches. We see a lot of convergent plate boundaries. Another one of our kind of classic landforms associated with subduction. Volcanoes too, okay? As these plates get shoved into one another, new magma is formed, okay? All kinds of energy there to convert this solid rock back into its liquid form. And that magma is going to find its way to the surface. The surface, I should say. And we get volcanoes. So we get these mountain ranges that include volcanoes, lined with these trenches, all classic examples of a subduction zone. Okay. An interesting kind of unique example of a convergent boundary is the Himalayas. Okay, notice what's happening here. It's two continental crusts. Two plates coming together, both continental crusts. So we don't have this density difference. Okay. So while we get some pretty big mountains here, we get the biggest mountains there. Okay. Two continents, continental crust, running into one another and just going up, right? Versus the oceanic crust. Questions so far? Talking fast because I don't want to run out of time. Stop me. The third plate boundary is a transform boundary. This is, it looks parallel. It should not be misinterpreted as like sliding easily next to one another. No, they're stuck together, right? They're being pushed against one another. But when they move side to side. So the example I like to use is to picture two pieces of sandpaper stuck together, like they're hard to move. But if you push hard enough for long enough, eventually they'll give way. And that's what happens along the transform boundary. The classic example of a transform fault boundary, would be in Southern California, the San Andreas Fault runs up the spine of California here through the deserts. Some really interesting photos of it, one's in the book actually. You'll notice that the transform boundaries are often associated with some other kind of boundary. So you can see we have along the North American west coast here, we have these areas of spreading and we have two plates coming together, and you know, these transform boundaries tend to be kind of the in-between parts. Speaking of faults, here in this part of the world, this part of the continent, we are very close to something called the New Madrid Fault. And faults are defined there for you. These are cracks in the crust. They result from all that pushing and pulling I described. We're not at a boundary here. Okay? Like, there aren't two plates converging at the Mississippi River. We're kind of in the middle of the North American plate. But this part of the North American plate, once upon a time, cracked. you've ever repaired a crack or patched something, the repair is never as good as the original. Okay? And if you haven't learned that, someday you will. Unless you're a really good carpenter or seamstress or whatever. It's really hard to get the repair to be similar to, or kind of structurally sound. And that's basically what happened here. A long time ago, 600 million years ago, that's a lot of millions of years. Everything I described about like that ocean, in that video, is 130 million years ago. So this is like way before that. North America cracked. And it cracked right around here. And those cracks filled. Magma came up, filled those spaces. And what's thought to be happening is that the stuff that filled those spaces is more dense than the stuff around it. So you've got this kind of, really dense stuff. Gravity's really acting upon it a lot more compared to the stuff around it, and it's causing destabilization. A couple hundred years ago, there were some major earthquakes in this area, repeatedly over a pretty short period of time. That really got things. It actually changed some landscapes. Had some very interesting hillsides and stuff, and whatever actually physically changed, like what things like, really got people's attention. To answer the question, are we in danger? Compared to other places, yeah, we are. But that doesn't mean that an earthquake is going to happen today. That's still really unlikely. But compared to Minnesota, for example, a lot more. Another kind of interesting example. This is a map of, I should point out, I didn't tell you. This is geological hazards, meaning hazards related to the movement of plates and seismic activities. Kind of a hotbed here. Okay, a little bit more here, and then we'll look at some rocks. Hot spots. This is yet another way that you can end up with seismic activity with mountains, and one more potential explanation for how a place got that. A hot spot is a particular one spot in the mantle where there is a, for one reason or another, is especially hot. There's a lot of convection happening, and there is space here in the lithosphere for that mantle, for the magma to get through from the mantle. Hawaii is shown here, is a really classic example of a chain of islands. There are many around the world that result from a hotspot. So if you look at the map, as a structure text, the hotspot is here. This is the big island of Hawaii. There's a new island forming south of Hawaii. The Pacific plate is moving to the north and to the west. And all of the other islands in the chain originated here. Okay, so we need to be, it's kind of maybe hard to picture at first, but the hot spot doesn't move. All right, that's the hot spot. It's hot and it's been hot and it's going to stay hot. It's the hot spot. The islands, the crust is moving over. Okay, so magma comes up, cools off, forms an island. Now that island gets pulled along with the plate. Magma comes up, forms an island. That island gets pulled along with the plate. Magma comes up, forms an island. It keeps happening. And you can, knowing how far they are from the hot spot, you can figure out how many years ago that was, and figure out how fast the plate's moving. Another example of this country, part of the world, is Yellowstone. There's a lot to look at here. You don't know what you're looking at unless you try to tell what's going on. But from the top right corner there, we're looking straight down at this part of the country. And maybe you can see it, maybe you can't, but I'm going to sort of tell you what you see, which is maybe you see a crater there. It looks a little bit like maybe the crater of a volcano. Because that's exactly what it is. It's called a caldera. And it is huge. It is many valleys and mountain ranges. I'm not looking at one. If I was standing here in Yellowstone, I wouldn't necessarily know I was in this big crater. But you are. And you are also see evidence of that all through what's called the Snake River Plain. Really beautiful part of the country. You can see these lava fields. Okay, that's what this is up here. Craters of the Moon is a national park. And really interesting place for a lot of reasons, one of which is it's lava just on the ground. Because a long time ago, a volcano. And that lava is, we can see examples of this all through, these are all volcanic lava. And they were all, at one point, originated where Yellowstone is now.
Okay.
You may have heard of Old Faithful in Yellowstone, Old Faithful, these geysers. You know, the ground is steaming because there's magma not far under the surface. So next time you go to Yellowstone, today's day. Okay, so talked a lot about plates moving, talked a lot about magma coming to the surface. This is the story of what happens once it's on the surface. Okay, the rock cycle. Rocks. Let's define rocks really quickly. Rocks are mixtures. Okay, rocks are mixtures of different chemical of different minerals. Okay, a mineral is a pure substance. Okay. Some kind of chemical, quartz comes to mind, silicon dioxide, okay? If it's pure silicon dioxide, I call it quartz, it's a mineral. If it's a mixture of quartz and other things, it's a rock, okay? So as I say rocks, we should be thinking of mixtures of chemicals. Okay? The igneous rock, oh, I should put this up to you. Rocks are put into three main categories, okay? Igneous, metamorphic, sedimentary, and that's it, okay? They're defined by how they're formed, not by what's in them. Okay, what's in them matters, but when we define it, again, when we're talking about what kind of rock this is, we're talking about how it's formed. Okay. Igneous rocks are simply cooled off magma. Magma came up, some mixture of chemicals, cooled off on the surface, I have an igneous rock. Once on the surface, weathering happens. Can be chemical weathering, can be physical weathering. Chemical weathering is chemical reactions, okay? Chemicals in the rock meeting other chemicals in the environment, chemical changes happen, okay? That breaks down the rock and changes the rock being chemically weathered. Physical weathering is a physical process. It's a result of wind and water moving over the surface, friction, okay? It's a result of freezing and thawing, okay? And over time, rocks break down, physically break down into smaller pieces. And all these pieces, however they were formed, get moved around. Erosion happens, they're transported to other places, like for example the bottom of an ocean, where they're subjected to huge amounts of pressure for long periods of time, and they're reformed into something new, sedimentary. Sedimentary includes that term sediment, okay? What is sediment? It's fine particles, it's things that are accumulating. Pressurize those, you get sedimentary rock. Either sedimentary rock or igneous rock could become metamorphic rock. What's required here is melting. Okay? It's not just pressure, but they're heated. And they're, I should say, reheated. They're melted and then they're brought back. Okay? So it's not igneous. Okay? It's not magma coming up in its original state. Becoming a rock, a new rock. It's a rock going down and changing and coming back. Okay? It never becomes magma again. It just becomes something else. Okay? So knowing what kind of rock is present, and knowing a little bit about the plate tectonics in the region, and knowing a little bit about Earth and how it's got out this way, we can maybe start to piece together the story of how this place got this way. Or one aspect of it. Mr. Zimmer is passing out some containers with rocks in them, which we'll talk about here in a second. You're going to need to share those. You need to get closer to somebody or a group of people than you should. I just wanted to point this out. This is something we can talk more about later also. I just wanted to show this because it's a significant part of this particular landscape that we're standing in right now. When I talk about continents moving and oceans forming and drying up, and all this stuff we're talking about in the order of millions of years. Glaciers, the last ice age was about 10,000 years ago. 10,000 years ago, not million, thousand. Okay? So this is on a much different time scale here, but still significant. And much like we're at this kind of interesting part of the continent where it cracked this one time and there's cool stuff happening there, we're also at this interesting part of the continent that was right on the edge of where the glaciers went. And you can tell a lot about a landscape from that, knowing that as well. Kind of leave that at that.
I don't want to get too deep.
An interesting thing to think about. Come back to that. Okay. Rocks. You got some rocks in front of you, hopefully. You've got three containers. One has igneous, one has sedimentary, one has metamorphic rocks. I tried to grab some examples of igneous rocks that were like classic examples, but also relevant to us here in Missouri. So what you have in there are, I just want to real quick do this and then we'll talk about this question. Obsidian, the pretty black one. It's like a chunk of glass. That's an igneous rock. And as are the other ones in that container. Compare that to granite, which is number two, or basalt, which is number three, or rhyolite, or lyolite, I'm not sure which one it is, which is number five. Okay? Obsidian is unique, and what's unique about it is its consistency. It's like glass. Well, the way that happens is that it's igneous, okay, so we should be imagining magma coming up from the bottom, from underneath, I should say, and cooling. And for obsidian to form, it needs to cool really fast. Like really fast. Compared to granite, for example, which cools really slow. And if you look at granite, it's got these little pockets. Like you can make out each individual mineral. Right? There's the pink stuff and the gray stuff and the white stuff. Granite cooled off slow enough that as it reached each substance's freezing point, each substance solidified individually. And you get this rock now that's a mixture of all the different minerals, but you can see kind of each mineral individually. Compared to obsidian, which cooled really fast, there was no time for that kind of separation to occur. You get this uniform distribution of this pretty clear glass stuff because it cooled off so fast that it couldn't separate the figure. Obsidian, they make surgical tools out of obsidian. You could make it really sharp. It was like a really prime arrowhead making rock. People that made arrowheads around the world. Really kind of an interesting thing. The other ones, sedimentary rocks. Look at those two. Number six, you have shale. Okay. Number eight, you have sandstone, and number 10, you have limestone. Three of those minerals that form most of the bedrock of Missouri. Sandstone, limestone, and shale. I didn't have an example of this yellow, which is dolomite, which is just like sandstone. But here we are in Missouri, and we're seeing mostly sedimentary rock. When I say bedrock, I'm talking about the solid rock that lies underneath the soil where plants are growing. So we'll think about that for a second here. Then you have metamorphic rocks. Number 11 is slate. Slate is interesting because it is shale that has been metamorphic. And if you hold those two things in your hand, you can see the difference. The slate is much smoother. It's got kind of a waxy feel. Versus the shale, which is much grittier. Okay? You can maybe picture, when you hold that slate, really fine particles that just melted all together and formed this. It almost looks like a crayon. That's what I feel when I feel slate. Marble. Marble is limestone. Okay, so you have limestone in the sedimentary bin. If that limestone was buried, heated, and then re-cooled again, you would have marble, which looks different. And then the the last one is number 15, is schist. Schist is the stuff that's underneath Manhattan, which they talked about in the video. At the beginning of my time. Okay. A sedimentary rock. Those particular examples are cool. They have little crystals in them. You might different crystals of different kinds, depending on the composition. Metamorphic rock, right? You can see that it was like a sedimentary type rock that was metamorphic. So, what do you think? Based on what you've seen and heard, what do the types of rock that form Missouri's bedrock suggest of the region's geological? Mumbles. Come in. Take a chance. Sedimentary rock. Where do you find a lot of sediment in this world?
The oceans.
The bottoms of oceans. Okay.
So Missouri used to be.
Yeah. More than once, actually. I'll show you a cool picture in a second. What about this one? Which rocks do you think are the oldest? This is a tricky question, and I can totally see why. It's not a trick question. To convince yourself. Which would be older? If I had two rocks that I found in the same place, which one's still as it was?
Igneous.
It's an igneous rock. It's still just like it was the first day it cooled. Back whenever it was magma and ended up on the surface. The sedimentary rock, you could assume, now this is a dangerous game here, because there's all kinds of stuff that happened. But it's new, right? It's the one that is like the remix. Right? It's unique, it's different, but it's made from the original. Okay. Missouri. Much of the Midwest was under an ocean more than once. And so this image on the left, about 75 million years ago, this is the Cretaceous. This is the body of water that was described in that video I showed you. This is why we find fossils of dinosaurs all along the edges of this ocean that once existed. At this period of time, Missouri was actually not so much. But it was before that, and it was multiple times in addition to that. So, notice the equator in the picture on the right.
What?
Think about that for a second.
Was
Southern hemisphere, right? Tropical, at the bottom of an ocean. So the next time you're walking through a creek bed by a neighborhood, and you find a rock with a seashell in it, like I did the other day and then forgot to bring to school today. You can think of that shallow inland sea 350 million years ago and know where that rock came from. Any questions before you go? Okay, can you make sure before you leave you bring up the rocks just to the front here?
Bring the rocks up, make sure you